Linda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Dead Point, written by Peter Temple and read by Michael Carman. The dedication reads, "For Gerhard and Karen, dear friends, for all the good times, Comdans, Claradin." Chapter 1. On a grey, whipped Wednesday in early winter, men in long coats came out and shot Renoir where he stood, noble, unbalanced, a foreleg hanging. In the terminating jolt of the bolt, many dreams died. Later, in the car, Cameron Del Rey sat behind the wheel, looked straight ahead, and made no move to get going. Harry Strang, head deep in his old racing overcoat, held his knuckles to his forehead. After a while he said, "Act of God. No bloody insurance for that." I was in shock, rubbing my hands together, trying to comfort myself. Most of them you can lose easily, and there are 50 reasons why. This one was the one we couldn't lose. If the ground was firm, if the horse didn't miss the start, and this horse was not going to miss the start, it was the best schooled horse in the world. If it didn't miss the start, it could streak the small field by at least 6 lengths, probably 10. And nobody knew that except us. The ground was firm. It didn't miss the start. All Renoir had to do was run 1,000 metres. On lazy days, not pushed, we had clocked him doing that in around 57 seconds. Only one horse running against him had come close to such a time. Afterwards, that creature swapped positive for melazonine and hadn't run under 65 since. So that didn't count. Drug-assisted times don't count. The day before, Harry Strang, walking next to Kathy Gale, big hand holding her elbow, said, "Can't win with you up. He can't win. Just mind you get him out with him. Keep him away from him. Don't touch him. He'll do the rest." All Kathy had to do was get the horse to jump cleanly out of the gate, number 6. Just urge him on, one bend. It didn't matter about looking for the short path. Being out wide meant nothing. He could beat them if he ran on the grandstand rail. The horse was 10 lengths better than any of the competition. Just go for the judge. Renoir, black as the grave, stood in the stall with the patient air of a Clydesdale. No sign of nerves. The VE 4000 showed me a calm, intelligent eye and Kathy Gale's face. Her mouth, the upper teeth resting on the plumped pillow of her lower lip, the tooth next to the canine that jutted slightly, that broke the rank of her seagull white choppers. I saw Kathy put out a hand and rub Renoir under his left ear. It twitched. He liked that. She had done it to him hundreds of times. They stood in the gate, a horse and a small rider, at their ease, friends together, greatly superior to the men and animals on either side of them. And when she urged him, he would respond with a great thrust of dark and gleaming thighs. The race caller said, "3 to come in. Very serious plunge on Renoir for a horse with one place from 9 starts. Never run this distance. He's shrunk from 30-1 to outright favourite 4-5 on. Pressure of the money started as a trickle. Not just the bookmakers either. The TAB pool is astonishing for a pretty ordinary autumn race." A pool swollen by our money. Ours and the money of all the price watchers who got on with us in the last moments before betting closed. "Last one goes in. That's red zone," said the caller. "The line's good. Light flashing." The moment. The gates opened, and they came out together, 8 abreast, but only for a moment because Renoir needed no more than half a dozen strides to draw away, a length, 2, 3. Then Kathy settled him. Didn't let him bolt. Used what she knew about sitting on horses to manage him. Just before the bend, she looked over her shoulder. Just a jerk of the head, saw the inadequate herd well behind her, and she took the horse over to the rail. In the straight, Renoir's dominance was complete. With 300 to go, he was 6 lengths clear, and Kathy was riding him hands and heels, copybook riding, and drawing further ahead with each stride. "Well, isn't this easy," said the caller. "Renoir's thrashing this field, drilling the bookies who got caught early. He's in another league altogether, and Kathy Gale isn't even..." I had Kathy and Renoir in perfect focus, all grace and power, an unbidden smile on my face. And then I saw her head drop, and her arms, in their silken sleeves, go forward to clutch the lovely black neck, and I saw shining horse and rider falling, falling, falling. All gainliness gone, all grace and power departed in a split second of agony. They fell, and she lay still, and he, the proud and lovely creature, struggled to stand, and the field had plenty of space in which to part and ride round them, so that some undeserving twosome could be declared winners. Now in the car, Harry took his hands from his face and fastened his seatbelt. "Home," he said. "Have a bit of bolly, thank the stars the Lord didn't taketh away the girl." On the way, on the hideous tollway, in post-adrenaline shock, I was thinking about life, the brevity, the silliness, my life in particular, the fragility of life, how unfair it was that the huge burden should be carried on such slender and brittle supports. When Cam said, driving with two fingers in a suicidal rush of trucks and buffheads, petrol heads, "The giveth is, we got average 15 with the books, just on 10 on the tote." I sat up, heart pumping as if from a dream of flight, enraged and irrational. "You put money on that?" I said. "A fucking thing not fit to lick Renoir's boots, shoes, whatever, hooves, bloody hooves." Harry had his head back against the headrest. "Jack," he said, sadly, "they don't have races with only one horse." I slumped in my seat, a child gently chastised. How often do you have to be told some things? Chapter 2. Lynn, the fourth Mrs. Harry Strang, opened a French door at the side of the mellow red brick house as we came up the gravel path from the carriage house. She had the sexy look of someone who'd been running, followed by a hot shower and a rough toweling. Her right hand came up, fell. She knew. She was once a trainer's wife. She knew. "Had better days," said Harry, without being asked anything. "Might have the bubbly in the study, love." In the awesome room, we stood with our backs to the 5-metre-high wall of books that held everything ever published on horses and horse racing, and looked out across the terrace and the lawn and the yew hedges to the naked maples moving like things possessed. There was a knock. Cam opened the door in the library wall, and Mrs. Aldridge came in with a tray. I saw the delicacies, salivated. I'd had them before, and they featured in my dreams. Ethereal capsules, a shell of champagne batter just puffed in hot oil. Inside, the teeth would meet a fresh oyster wrapped in tissue-thin smoked salmon. Lynn Strang followed, 3 flutes on a silver tray, a bottle of Bollinger uncorked, stoppered with a sterling silver device. Harry looked at his 2 women. "What would I do?" he said, head to one side. I'd never seen him like that. "Stuff yourself with all the wrong things," said Mrs. Aldridge sharply. She left the room. Harry looked at Lynn. "Glass short," he said.
"No," said Lynn. "Can't bear racing post-mortems."
She touched his cheek, smiled a brisk nurse smile, and left. Harry poured. Cam and I waited for the toast. Harry always proposed the toast to the next time. It didn't come. He sipped, and we sipped. My eyes met Cam's. "Well," Harry said, putting his glass down on the tray, looking out at his garden, "I'm thinking of giving it away." I didn't want to hear this. It had been in my mind from the moment he said, "What would I do?"
"An act of God," said Cam.
He was holding his flute to the light, studying the minute bubbles.
"Whoever that is, there'll be better days."
"Not today's stuff," said Harry, still not looking at us. "That's the business. The punt's the punt. Can't cop it. Drop it. The commissioner. That's what makes me think it's time to shut the shop."
"We'll fix the Cynthia thing," said Cam. "We're working on that."
I wanted a second Cam's statements, but I didn't believe them, and I couldn't find a quick reassuring lie. Harry picked up his glass, had a generous sip, shook his head, pretended to cheer up. Gotta be good for you, don't you reckon? He said.
We'll fix the Cynthia thing, repeated Cam.
Cynthia had been the commission agent for four big plungers, marshalling teams of old-age pensioners, young-age pensioners, the board, a retired bank manager, two strippers gone to flab, an ageing hooker relishing undemanding vertical work. The most recent plunge had been a simple matter involving a nightclub owner who believed correctly that a non-performing horse he secretly owned through his sister-in-law's cousin would show unexpected ability in a feature race at Flemington. Afterwards, Cynthia had collected the large sum her platoon of punters had taken off the bookies. She was in her old Mazda, driving to meet Cam, cruising down a narrow Yarraville street when a four-wheel drive forced her to the curb. Two men got out, asked for the money. She said she didn't think that was on, and in full view of an old man on sticks and a woman on a bicycle, one of the men punched her in the face six or seven times, held her by the hair, turned her head and broke her jaw and her nose, and impacted her cheekbones. When they were gone, she got Cam on her mobile, speaking thickly through the blood and the crushed cartilage, then lost consciousness. Cam more or less drove across country to reach her, ignoring traffic lights and stop signs and other vehicles, took her to Footscray General. The number the woman on the bicycle had written down belonged to a vehicle stolen less than an hour earlier. It was found in the city in Latrobe Street, just after 6 p.m. Cynthia now had less than 40% sight in one eye. We weren't going to be able to fix Cynthia. And the Cynthia thing wasn't any easier.
Can't get over that, said Harry. Not a thing used to happen. Bash a woman like that bastard to do anything.
I knew what he was thinking. He was thinking about his women. His wife, 30 years his junior, the final fling, and his housekeeper of 35 years, a person who left England for him, left home and kin, to look after a broken-bodied jockey. He was thinking about Lynn and Mrs. Aldridge because he loved them, and he was fearful for them. Not for himself, not for Harry Strang, the champion jockey of whom an English racing writer once wrote, "In his presence, agitated English horses become calm, and calm English jockeys lose their composure." Cam knew too. He finished his glass, poured for us, for himself.
"Just run through, boys," he said, his face expressionless. "Too clever for banks, too lazy for drugs. Somebody told him about Sin, one of her troops will be right. We'll get there, sort it out."
We wouldn't. Cam and I had already been over Cynthia's troops. All we found was that one had gone to Queensland suddenly. So did we. We joined the woman at her ailing aunt's bedside. She was so shocked and showed so little evidence of newfound riches that Cam slipped her two $100 notes when we left.
"Won't make any quick decision," said Harry. "Nothing coming up. Sleep on it a bit."
We finished the bottle and didn't move on to the customary second one. Harry came to the front gate with us, out in the blustery night, trees thrashing, held me back, fingers like a bulldog clip on my left bicep.
"Two knocks in a row, Jack," he said. "You'll be hurting. Not a write-off, though. Get 25-30 cents in the dollar back, thereabouts." "Can't drop it, cop it," I said. "Isn't that right?"
He squeezed my arm. More pain.
"Remember the Bank of Strang? Cash advances for the creditworthy. Also a little legal matter. Needs some consultant. Next week suit?"
"Day and night," I said.
"Cam will make a time."
He let go. We looked at each other. "Harry," I said, no mental activity preceding what followed, pure emotion. "Cynthia, we'll take care of that." The front door of the house opened. Over Harry's head I saw Lynn Strang, short, strong, warm peach-coloured light on her hair and shoulders, a carpet of peach laid around her shadow on the broad veranda.
"I wanted to say goodbye. I was upstairs," she said. Something in her tone, not relief, but something like that.
In the street beyond the high red brick wall, Cam started the transport we'd come in, a much modified vehicle apparently known to some as an 8-bore street slut. It made a feline noise, the sort of sound a prehistoric giant saber-toothed tiger might have made. I raised my hand at Lynn. She waved back. "We'll fix it," I said to Harry, repeating the stupid, unfulfillable promise.
"Wouldn't surprise me," Harry said, no confidence in his voice. "Pair of bright fellas like yourselves."
Cam drove me to my place of residence, the old boot factory in North Fitzroy, early Saturday night traffic. Lots of taxis, sober people going out for it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.